week.
Oh, I just decided to stay home for some change.
Well, you need to come.
I will.
Church, if you have something for the annual report, please make
make sure that that is into the office by Monday morning so that Avis can put the report together. Next Sunday after worship is the annual congregational meeting. Please plan to remain for that event. This is our once a year annual congregational meeting. There's also information in your bulletin about the Super Bowl of Caring that's coming up. It's happening now. Over the next 2 weeks, you can place your donated cans of soup at the goalpost that you support in the fellowship hall on the side of your favorite team. After worship on the 12th of February, there will be a soup luncheon hosted by the deacons. Of course, you're invited to participate by wearing your team colors if you would like. You can also donate cash, and all of these donations will go to Project Share. There's a sign-up sheet in Fellowship Hall if you would like to host a time of fellowship after worship. Please feel free to sign up for that. And also there is information about the end of year giving statements. We've recently switched to a different system, and so those are a little bit delayed this year, but they will be ready for pickup next Sunday in Fellowship Hall if you are here. And if you are not here next Sunday to pick them up in person, they will then be mailed to you. Also this week, it's not in the bulletin, it was in the update if you happen to read that, but our own Director of Christian Education Emerita, Debbie Madden, received the Sustained Lifetime Achievement Award from the Association of Partners for Christian Education at their meeting in Birmingham, Alabama this week. And so we congratulate Debbie on her Lifetime Achievement Award. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice together and be glad in it. Let us worship.
Thank you.
scriptures how he would suffer and die and then rise from the dead on the third day. Through his death and resurrection, the forgiveness of sin is now possible for all who repent and turn to him. Together, let us pray. Merciful God, you pardon all who truly repent and turn to you. We humbly confess our sins and ask your mercy. We have not loved you with a pure heart, nor have we loved our neighbor as ourselves. We have not done justice, loved kindness, or walked humbly with you, our God. Have mercy on us, O God, in your loving kindness, in your great compassion, cleanse us from our sin. Create in us a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within us. Do not cast us from your presence, or take your Holy Spirit from us. Restore to us the joy of your salvation, and sustain us with your bountiful Spirit. Brothers and sisters, hear the good news. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone. Behold, a new life is begun. Hear and believe the good news, and know that in Jesus Christ you are forgiven.
Good morning. pew Bibles, be found on page 866. Hear what the Lord says. Rise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the controversy of the Lord, and you enduring foundations of the earth. For the Lord has a controversy with his people, and he will contend with Israel. O my people, what have I done to you? In what have I wearied you? Answer me. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt, and redeemed you from the house of slavery, and I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember now what King Balak of Moab devised, what Balaam, son of Beor, answered him, and what happened from Shittim to Gilgal, that you may know the saving acts of the Lord. With what shall I come before the Lord, and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn from my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Second lesson today is from 1 Corinthians, chapter 1, beginning at verse 18. Listen again to God's word. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God the world did not know God, through wisdom God decided through the foolishness of our proclamation to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs, and Greeks desire wisdom, but we proclaim Christ crucified, stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles, but to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. Consider your own call, brothers and sisters. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, things that are not, to reduce to nothing things that are, that no one might boast in the presence of God. He is the source of your life in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, in order that, as it is written, that the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Let us pray. Make us to know your ways, O Lord, and teach us your paths. Lead us in your truth and teach us, for you are the God of our salvation, and our hope is in you all day long. Amen. Sometimes we human beings can be a forgetful bunch. We forget where we put our car keys and our reading glasses. We forget birthdays and anniversaries. We forget to buy milk and bread at the grocery store. Sometimes we even forget and doubt that God loves us, that we are precious in His sight. That's what the text from Micah boils down to this morning. Israel has forgotten how to be in relationship with God. They have forgotten the covenant. They need to be reminded. At the beginning of Micah chapter 6, there is this courtroom scene that God has called, and God is the plaintiff. Micah is his messenger, co-counsel, we might say. God's people, Israel, are the defendants in this courtroom, and the mountains are the witnesses. Rise, plead your case, God commands his people. Tell me what it is I've done wrong, God says. Tell me what burdens I've laid on you to cause this. The Israelites come before God full of bravado. They think they are in the right and God is in the wrong. They think this is an open and shut case. They will win. God is the guilty party. I was channel surfing the other day and came across an old episode of Murder, She Wrote. Hadn't seen that show in years. I used to watch it with my grandma. Then I found Matlock and Perry Mason. And I started to think of this common thread that runs through all of those shows. When Jessica Fletcher or Ben Matlock or Perry Mason are trying to solve a crime, they give the guilty party what? Just enough rope to hang himself. Just enough. I think that's what God seems to be doing with Israel. The courtroom scene in Micah is like a trial when the key witness finally incriminates himself on the stand in front of the judge and the jury. Oh, my people, what have I done to you? God asks. In what way have I wearied you? He says. Answer me. And then he rehearses the history of Israel, salvation history. Was it when I brought you out of slavery, out of Egypt? Was it when I gave you Moses and Aaron and Miriam to be your leaders? Was it when I protected you from your enemies? Was it when I brought you into the promised land, this land flowing with milk and honey at Gilgal? When was it? God asks. And Israel gets just enough rope to hang themselves. When we read the Old Testament, it can at times seem awfully dull and boring, all those rules and regulations, who can eat what, when, where, and why, and how. But God's law is given for the benefit of God's people. It's meant to be life-giving, not burdensome, life-draining. But the people of Israel, they quickly forget who God is and what God's character and will are. They break their part of the covenant. They leave their part of the covenant unfulfilled. The Israelites are kind of like us today. They think they know what's best for them, what is best for their lives. And their hearts have grown hardened towards God because of what they perceive to be all of these burdens that God has laid on them in the law. I wonder how our hearts are hardened today. Is life not what you expected it to be? Are you angry with God, with your neighbor, with yourself? Are you burdened by feeling wronged? Do you think that you have to work just a little bit harder for God to like you? Do you think that if you could just get your life together, if you could just get some more things in order, that everything would be okay? If you could just catch a break. After God speaks, demanding that the Israelites give their evidence about what God has done, a representative of Israel steps forward. And from his tone, it's hard to tell if he is exasperated or frustrated or just being sarcastic, but he asks, "With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high?" That's his question. With what shall I come before the Lord? And then he lists this whole long list of things. And they grow increasingly different and difficult. How about a burnt offering, God? We know that's a pleasing odor for God to smell from Genesis. Or what about a couple of year-old calves? How about I sacrifice a couple of year-old calves? Or how about 1,000 rams, God? If that's not good enough for you, what about olive oil poured out in immeasurable abundance, 10,000 rivers? The exaggerated magnificence of each successive offering finds its sarcastic culmination in the offer of child sacrifice. My firstborn, is that what you want, God? Child sacrifice is something so horrific that God specifically prohibits it in the law of Moses. The prophets continually condemn this possibility that Israel might offer a human sacrifice. And here we come to the heart of the matter. Whether Israel's being sarcastic or not, they've forgotten. They've forgotten who God is and what God's character and will are. And so Israel needs to be reminded what it is to be in relationship with the Lord. They've not fulfilled their part of the covenant. They've not been faithful to God, even though God has been faithful to them, even though God has been kind and loving and patient with them. And so they think that their solution to this problem lies in ritual purity. Well, if we just offer enough sacrifices, if we just pour out enough oil, what can I give God to appease God, to be right again with God? What can I sacrifice for God? The Israelites look at the covenant that God made with them all those years before. They look at it as sort of like a contract, the party of the first part and the party of the second part and so forth and so on. They see their relationship with God as a series of transactions. If I do this, then you'll do that for me, won't you, God? And if I don't do that, then you won't do this to me. Right, God? But Micah steps to the courtroom floor and says, hang on a minute. He's already told you, O mortal, what is good. God's already told you what you need to do, and it has nothing to do with calves and rams and burnt offerings and rivers of oil. What does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? God has told you what is good. It's not burnt offerings. It's not 1,000 rams. It's not a flood of oil. God has told you what is good. It's about ethical purity. It's about doing the right thing. It's about loving God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind. And it's about loving your neighbor as you love yourself. It's about remembering that the moral law, how God's people love and serve one another, has priority over the ceremonial law. He has told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice, and to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God. There's a scene in the Gospels where Jesus and his disciples are walking through some grain fields on one Sabbath day. And as they are walking along, the disciples pluck some of the grain from the field because they're hungry. The Pharisees, the religious police, see this And immediately they criticize Jesus for allowing his disciples to so flagrantly break the Sabbath law. They were working in a field, they were plucking grain, they were eating it. But then Jesus tells a story about David, before David is king, and how he and his companions came to the house of God one day, and they were hungry, they were famished, they had nothing to eat. And this was when Abiathar was high priest. But Abiathar didn't have any regular bread. He only had the holy showbread, the bread of prisons, bread which was only for God. But Abiathar gave David and his companions the showbread because they were hungry. What good is bread for God when men are hungry? The Pharisees are interested in the letter of the law. You shouldn't pluck grain on the Sabbath. But Jesus comes to live out the spirit of the law. If you're hungry, eat. Jesus comes and says the Sabbath was made for humankind, not the humankind for the Sabbath. The Israelites, they've got the law turned upside down. They've forgotten that God's law is relational. It's for them, not the other way around. It's not about ticking boxes and checking lists. It's not about offering enough rams and calves and rivers of oil. It's about doing justice and loving kindness and walking humbly with God. The law is not meant to be onerous. It's not meant to be a burden. That's what the Israelites had turned it into. They forgot that the Sabbath was made for humankind and not the other way around. I wonder if we don't also think of our relationship with God in much the same way. Do we think believing in Jesus is sort of like signing a contract? Do we have a relationship with God based on transactions? God, I'll go to church every Sunday if you just give me this, or I'll give some extra money to this charity if you just do that for me. Dear brothers and sisters, God isn't some kind of cosmic bank teller, ticking boxes and checking lists. Our relationship with God isn't based on what we can get when we give the bare minimum. There's a grave danger in substituting gifts or bribes and a dead moralism for the radical and continuing repentance that Christ demands of his followers in the gospel. Follow me, take up your cross daily and follow me, Jesus says. Not when it's convenient, not when you feel like it. Every day. Our relationship with God is meant to be relational, but sometimes we forget and it becomes transactional. That's the beauty of the incarnation, though. It is so personal, relational for us. In Jesus Christ, God comes to us and God lives among us. God reminds us just how much he loves us. He demonstrates it by stretching out his arms on the cross. And Jesus calls his followers to come together, to live and to work together as his body, as the church, so that we might continually bear witness to one another. Martin Luther said, we need to hear the gospel every day because we forget it every day. And that hit me like a ton of bricks, because it's true. We need to hear the gospel every day because we forget it every day. It's like what Paul is writing to the Corinthians about how God is stronger than the weakest human and how God's foolishness is wiser than the wisest human. And he writes this, God is the source of your life in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, in order that, as it is written, that the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. Let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. It's not our doing. It's not our human strength. We boast in the Lord. Israel forgot who God is, what God's character and will are. They were boasting in themselves. Sometimes we do the same. Sometimes we're tempted to rely on ourselves instead of finding our strength in the Lord. Micah, the prophet, calls Israel, and he calls us to remember that our relationship with God then isn't based on rules and checklists and sacrifices, but in doing justice and in loving kindness and in walking humbly each day with our God. Amen. Dealing with COVID, there are a number in our congregation 11 at last count who have been dealing with COVID. Many of them are recovering or recovered. Some are still quite sick. I encourage you to pray, especially for Fred Seltzer, who is still quite sick. His doctor is concerned and trying to figure out next steps. So I invite you to keep Fred in your prayers. Dick Darr as well, and Teddy McKeon as well. Let us join our hearts and minds together and go to God in prayer. Come before you this day, O Lord, not with sacrifices, not with calves or rams or rivers of oil, but we come before you, O God, with humble, open hearts. We come before you, O God, seeking to love one another. We come before you, O God, hoping to learn each and every day how to walk humbly with you. And so as we come this day before your throne of grace, O God, we come lifting our prayers and our praises. We praise your holy name, O God, that you have delivered us from sin, death, and evil, that in the life, death, and resurrection you have granted us life in Christ. We praise your holy name, O God, that you love us so wondrously, so completely, so fully. And we pray, O God, that as we have been loved, we might also learn how to love one another, to love those who are hard to love, to share your love, O God, in humble, practical ways with this world, O Lord, not with arrogance, but with humility, that we might share your love, O God, in ways that make this world a better place, in ways that help us to know your grace, your mercy, and your peace. We come before you this morning, O God, and we lift up our prayers. We lift up our prayers, O Lord, that have been spoken aloud and prayers that remain hidden in our hearts. We lift up our prayers, O God, for so many concerns, for so many joys, for so many blessings, for so much pain. We pray for our world, O God, a world that is continually riven with strife, a world that continues to struggle, even in the midst of so much blessing. We pray, O Lord, for those who are living in warfare and violence. We remember especially our brothers and sisters in Ukraine. We pray for those who are hungry, those who are fearful, those who are lonely and afraid. We pray for our own country, for those who disagree with one another, that we might have healthy and open debate, O God, but also that we might know what it means to be people who live with hope and trust, not with fear and anger. Lord, as we gather this day, we pray for our community. We pray for those in this congregation who are struggling with health issues, especially those who are dealing with COVID. We pray today especially for Fred and for Dick, for Peggy. Lord, that you be with them, that you grant them healing and wholeness. Lord, there are many other prayers that we have this day. They lie heavy on our hearts, O God. They keep us awake at night. They steal into our minds on a quiet Tuesday afternoon. Our worries are with us always, O God, along with our fears. But help us to know, O Lord, that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you are also with us always, to the end of the age and beyond. So help us, O Lord, in the midst of our doubts, in the midst of our worries and fears, to trust in you, to find grace for each and every day. For we pray all this, trusting in the name of Jesus, the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We have the opportunity and privilege to give back to God a portion of what God has given to us in this life. The offering plates remain at the doors for your use. Let's take this moment during the offertory to consider God's generosity and our response.
Thank you.
strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, and help the suffering. Honor all people, love, and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now. Remain with you.